We start the hike and we hike almost 1,000 meters of elevation. When we get closer to the top, we get closer to the massifs, close to the glaciers. It is something that if you are there and you leave it, you can't believe it. And I think that that is something magic and makes the experience much more interesting. My name is Julián López, Julián or Julian, English or Spanish. I'm a UIMLA mountain guide. I am currently on course for being an IFMGA guide, full certified guide. I'm a physical educator and I've been guiding since 2008 all over South America. I'm specialized in South Argentina, in Patagonia, that is my homeland. I've been climbing a mountaineer around Patagonia since I was born, since I was 4 years old, and I really love this place. I think that this place is something that everyone in the world should see once in a lifetime, and that is my main motivation for guiding here. We will talk a little bit about Argentina. If you get to Argentina, what to see and what to eat in Argentina. And then we will go over South Patagonia, a city called El Chaltén, that is the city that holds the greatest granite massifs in South America, with Fitzroy Mountain and Cerro, Torre. Then we will talk a little bit about logistics for an adventure like this. We will talk about some products that we offer in South Patagonia and that you can join, share with us in 2022 or next season. So once we get to Argentina, we fly into Buenos Aires. That is the main city in Argentina and that is not close at all to El Chaltén. As you can see in that slide, Argentina is a very long country. It is the southernmost country in South America, and it is 5,000 kilometers long. So there are many things to see in such a big country. And Buenos Aires is almost 2,000 or 2,500 kilometers far from El Chaltén, the city we will talk about. Once you arrive to Buenos Aires is a very modern city with a lot of European influence and with many facilities and many things to visit and to see. And there are a lot of highlights in Argentina to visit apart from South Patagonia. I will talk mainly about two highlights, Iguazu Falls and Aconcagua. So this is the city of Buenos Aires, the place where you will fly in if you come from Europe, probably. Or from the United States. And in Buenos Aires, you will see that two big cultures crash, let's say, that are the two very different things that you can find in Argentina, the tango culture and the European influence. So we have two very different aspects of what we call our native, our local culture that are very interesting to see. The tango culture is something that was built in early 19th century, and has a lot to do with music, with urban places like Buenos Aires. And the gaucho culture has to do with the countryside, with cattle growing and with horses and everything you can find outside of the main city. So here we have some gauchos dancing, folkloric music. Just to mention something about local food, empanadas or a gaucho making an asado, a barbecue, a local barbecue, something that you can't miss if you visit Argentina, you know. We have lots of plants of cattle growing here in Argentina. So this is Iguazu Falls. Iguazu Falls are a huge system of waterfalls are in the corner between Argentina, Brazil, and Paraguay in the northeast part of Argentina. They have almost 100 meters high, and you can get very close by a system of boats and walkways in a national park. So it is very easy to get very near, very close to the waterfalls, and it is very interesting. Also, we have Aconcagua Mountain in the central west part of Argentina in a state called Mendoza. This mountain is very interesting and very unique because it is a 7,000 meter peak. It is part of the 7,000 meter peak tour around the world, and it is the highest mountain outside the Himalaya range in the world. And of course, it is the highest mountain in the western and southern hemisphere. So there is a huge movement around this mountain, a lot of mountaineers coming every year and visiting it and trying to and attempting to make it summit. And in the southern part of Argentina, we have Cerro Torre Massif in the Glaciares National Park, which is for me one of the most beautiful things I've ever seen in my life. I've traveled a lot around the world. I still think this way. And this is what we will talk about in this webinar. Parque Nacional Los Glaciares is a national park in the Patagonia region that is around these two lakes, Viedma Lake and Argentino Lake. Parque Nacional Los Glaciares is a national park that was built to preserve the environment involved Southern Patagonian ice field. We have a huge ice field in Patagonia that is 400 kilometers long and 100 kilometers wide, and is the third mass of ice in the world, of continental ice in the world. Greenland, Antarctica, and then this Patagonic ice field. This is something worth to see. It is a huge system of glaciers, almost 50 glaciers coming out from this ice field, and the vast majority of these glaciers come down to the Argentinian side. Down to the Indian side, they make fjords and go to the ocean, so they are very difficult to visit. But in the Argentinian side, we have these lakes, and we get close to the glaciers and see it, the whole spectacle, and it's something that it is really, really interesting. Los Glaciares National Park was built in 1937. 30% of it is ice, and all the rest is on the Argentinian side, that is either forest or desert. The eastern you get, the more desert you have. You can see there are two main cities, El Chaltén and El Calafate. El Calafate is the biggest city here, and from El Calafate, you can go for a day tour to Perito Moreno Glacier, that is the biggest glacier coming down from the ice field. And 240 kilometers north, you can see El Chaltén. El Chaltén is a very small city with 600 inhabitants that is close to Cerro, Torre, and Fitz. So this is Perito Moreno Glacier. This is the front of the glacier coming down to the Argentino Lake. People there visiting every day the glacier. You can make a boat also, getting very close to the front of the glacier. And here we have El Chaltén area. El Chaltén is on the lower right side of the presentation here. And as you can see, Fitzroy and Rotorua are close. And we have some highlights here. Laguna de los Tres, Laguna Sucia, and Piedras Blancas that are part of one of the products that we offer. So this is the way to El Chaltén. On the right side is Fitzroy Massif with all its seven summits, being the highest one, with 3,405 meters. And on the left side, we have Cerro Torre Massif with 3,100 meters. Something interesting, this road comes from the east to the west to get into El Chaltén. If you see the environment, you will see that this road is in a very desert land. We call this place Estepa, and it is very dry because all the moisture coming from the Pacific Ocean already crashed into these giants and poured all the water on the western side of the massifs, making the ice field, this southern Patagonic ice field. So a little amount of the moisture comes across the massifs, making a very long stripe of Andean Patagonic forest. And then eastern to that, there isn't any more moisture to drop in the ground. So we have a very desert land called Estepa. So we have these very different three environments from the east to the west, the Estepa, the desert, then the forest, and then the glaciers. This is El Chaltén, very small town that receives thousands of people every year come to visit these mountains that are so, so beautiful. Chaltén is close to these two rivers, the Fitzroy River here and the last river. Here we have another picture of this cozy little town with the mountains that you can see to the west side. And this is the view to the east side. You see the desert. This is called Cerro Pirámides, Pirámides Mountain. There isn't even one tree there. And this is to the west side with all these glaciers coming down from the granite. We have two different itineraries that we will cover today. And the first one is the Fitzroy and Cerro Torre Massifs, hiking to its base camps and getting as close as we can to its walls. On this hike, Fitzroy and Cerro Torre Massif hikes, we come out from El Chaltén, we hike on day one to Laguna de los Tres, that is the best close-up we can get to Cerro Fitzroy, and then we come down and sleep in Camp 1, that is Point Seno campsite. Then we hike from Camp 1 to Camp 2, that is Laguna Torre, and we get the closest we can to Cerro Torre, and then we hike out to El Chaltén on day 3. Something interesting I didn't tell you about El Chaltén is that El Chaltén means the Smoky Mountain, and it is a name that originally comes from our Neker language, that is the local native people that lived here before us and named the place El Chalten. El Chalten is actually the name that they used to call the Mount Fitzroy, and they used to call it that way because El Chalten means smoky mountain. And even though it can look like a volcano, and perhaps that's why they called it Smoky Mountain, it is not a volcano, but it is usually full of clouds on its top. So it looks like a smoky mountain. So that's the reason why it is called, the mountain was called El Chalten, and now the town is called El Chalten. El Chalten is a place where we can have four seasons in a day. It's a place where the weather is the most interesting feature that we have. So it is something very interesting to take into account, and it is something also very interesting to be there and see what four seasons in a day means, and also to feel the power of wind and the power of nature on a place like Patagonia. So day one is coming out from El Chalten to Poinsenot campsite, and we are walking 8 kilometers to camp and then 3 kilometers to Laguna de los Tres. This is the kind of hike that anyone can do. The trail is mainly flat, except for the last climbing of 1 hour. It's something that we can do with very little gear, and it is not very technical. This is the way to enjoy. Here we have a picture of the trail in autumn. This is the Lenga tree that loses its leaves during autumn, and before losing their leaves, they become red and yellow and orange, so they make a show that is worth seeing sometime. People hiking the Lenga forest to Fitzroy base camp. And here in the back, you can see the switchbacks of the last section climbing up to this moraine. And on the other side, we have Laguna de los Tres, very close to Fitzroy Mountain. So that section of switchbacks is the only rocky, and it is physically demanding because it goes uphill for almost 1 hour, 1 hour and a half. This is the last section of the climbing. There are lots of tourists getting there. And this is what day one gives us to see. It's amazing. Anyone wanting to climb Fitzroy would come this way. So it's very interesting to know that it is called De los Tres. De los Tres means in Spanish, the lake of the three people. And it is called that way because the first climbers attempting to climb Fitzroy were three Italians in the 30s. And they came this way and they started climbing the glacier, and some people with them, with the team, stayed this side of the glacier, and they called, there are the three people. This is the glacier of the three people. So that is the reason why this is called that way. So from here, we can see a very close view of Fitzroy East Wall. We can see the whole way that the first climbers that made the summit of Fitzroy achieved in 1952. These people were French, and they were the same French that climbed the first 8,000 meter peak, Annapurna, in 1951. So 1 year after that, they came here and they made the first ascension of this mountain. So we can see several pictures of Fitzroy East Face. And this is something that usually happens, that here we see the smoky mountain and the clouds on top. Fitzroy is not a mountain that allows us to see its top very easily. Fitzroy likes people struggling and making an effort and having patience for seeing the summit. So sometimes we get there and we wait for a while until the clouds move a little bit and we get to glimpse the summit of Fitzroy. Sometimes we walk for several days and we get to see the summit for 10 minutes. And I think that is something magic and makes the experience much more interesting, you know? So after being in summit of this hike in Laguna de los Tres, we go down from Laguna de los Tres and we see to the east side all the Viedma Lake here back in the background. And we see these little two lakes called Mother and Daughter Lakes. I chose this picture for you to see what will be day two hike across these two Mother and Daughter Lakes. Day two, perhaps something about the night. We sleep in Poinsenot campsite. That is a campsite that is very beautiful inside the Lenga forest, in a very beautiful place near Piedras Blancas River, near Sucio River. And when we wake up in the morning, we either hike to Piedras Blancas Glacier on the left or to Laguna Sucia on the right. We choose where to hike according to the weather, because hiking to get to Laguna Sucia, Sucio Lake means dirty lake. It is called that way because it is usually full of little icebergs that make the water look dirty, but actually it is very, very pure. if the weather is very hard, this hike is not advisable, so we go to Piedras Blancas viewpoint, this glacier on the left side. On this day, we will hike 15 kilometers and the climbing will be very little. We will hike 15 kilometers on a trail like this that is very easy. And we will go by these two lakes, mother and daughter, that are very beautiful. And in the end of this, let's say, traverse, from one side to the other, we start in one place and we finish on the other. At the end of this day's traverse, we will get to see Cerro Torre, like you see in this picture. Cerro Torre is a very interesting mountain. It is everything here. This place is a climbing mecca, but Cerro Torre is a very interesting mountain that was claimed to be one of the most difficult mountains in the world. It was first climbed in 1974. Cerro Torre is a very sharp mountain with very difficult features and a lot of glaciers, the base, and it's not a very easy place to go climbing. This is the way we hike on day two near Cerro Torre until we get to the lake that is on the base of Cerro Torre and at the place where these two huge glaciers meet. You know, this glacier, white glacier on the left is the Grande Glacier, the big glacier, and the glacier on the right side is the Torre Glacier coming from Torre Mountain. The glacier on the right side is round because it is full of debris, rocks falling from the side of the mountain. So both glaciers meet and they drop a lot of icebergs on the lake, icebergs that we can see near this beach that we visit on day two. So here you have some tourists. It is interesting to tell that in 1953, someone, an Italian, claimed to have climbed Cerro Torre through the east face. When he made that claim, no one believed he did. So for almost, well, until today, he's still alive. He claims that he made the first ascension of Cerro Torre. Well, that's a very polemic story and main part of the climbing community do not believe what he says. But this guy was called Tessa de Maestri, and he used to visit this place. He actually came a lot of times, and he had this viewpoint here on the left. This is very beautiful, and that we visit on day three of this hike in the morning. And this viewpoint allows us to get very close to Cerro Torre. This is something that coming to this viewpoint is something that is not common. People usually come to Cerro Torre Lake for a day hike, so they get to the lake and they go back to town. We like camping near the lake because that allows us to get an early start in the morning and get to this viewpoint, have these kind of views, and then people hike out through this valley, still seeing Cerro Torre, but getting farther and farther until we get to El Chaltén. This is something that we really enjoy doing. You know, this hike is very beautiful and it's very easy, so anyone can come to this hike. And one thing that we have to take into account is the weather rules in South Patagonia, and we have to be equipped for harsh weather. There is a saying that there is no bad weather, but bad preparation. So if we prepare well, we should be able to visit this place, even though the wind is very, very strong, or even though it's a little bit rainy. So what we usually do is offering fourth day optional. We love this place, Loma del Pliegue Tumbado. It is a hike that starts in El Chaltén. It goes over 10 kilometers to this summit, and then it comes back to El Chaltén the same way. What we usually do is people come out from Cerro Torre the third day of the previous hike. They sleep in their hotel, and the next morning we wake up early and we do this hike. It is very, very beautiful, and we can take a rest in and a shower after two nights camping. So why we do love this hike? We love this hike because we go on top of this little mountain called Loma del Pliegue Tumbado. We hike 10 kilometers in and 10 kilometers out, and we hike almost 1,000 meters of elevation. We have this kind of views when we start the hike. And when we get closer to the top, we get closer to the Massifs, and we can see these kind of landscapes. Here are people climbing to the summit of this Loma del Pliegue Tumbado hill. And when we get to the top, we get these kind of landscapes that are very, very beautiful. The thing that I like the most about this hike is that it gives us a full panoramic 360 degrees view of the whole area. You know, we can see Cerro Torre. This is the only place where we can see Cerro Torre and Cerro Fitzroy at the same time. So that was all about this first hike, Cerro Torre and Cerro Fitzroy hike in El Chaltén area. it is interesting for you to know that we can prepare the hike anywhere, any way you want. If you come to El Chaltén, you can go do this hike for the day to Laguna de los Tres and back to El Chaltén, and then go for the day to Laguna Torre and back to El Chaltén and sleep every night in a hotel. We'd rather do it camping because the experience is absolutely different, and sleeping in Andean Patagonic forests is something that is part of the experience of visiting this place. So we really advise people to try also this part of the experience. This second hike that we'll talk about now is a little different. The previous hike had the highlight of getting close to the mountains and see Cerro Torre and Fitzroy walls. And this hike is a little different because the highlight of this hike is getting close to the ice field. So remember that we had this huge ice field on the west side of the mountains. So if we hike enough, we can go and get to the other side of the mountains and get to see the ice field. So this is the highlight of this hike. Huemul is the name of this deer, the local deer. There are many around and they are endangered. They are very friendly, so we usually see them from the trail. And well, they are called Huemul, and that's why we call this hike the Huemul hike. And also because in the middle of the hike, we have this huge mountain called the Huemul mountain. The Huemul loop is the loop around the mountain. We start in El Chaltén, we go for a day, camp one. Then on day two, we do an ice trek on Tunnel Glacier and sleep here. On day three, we go from camp two and hike to camp three. Del Viento Hut is the name of the place. And on day four, we cross over another saddle that gives us again a very beautiful view of the west part of the national park and the ice field, and hike down to camp four in a very beautiful place called Tunnel Tempanos Bay. On day five, we hike out to El Chaltén again. Let's overview a little bit about this hike. Here we have day one. This is the way to Toro Lake. On the left side, you can see Huemul Mountain. And on the far end of the picture, you can see the glacier that we will be hiking on day two. Here, it is a little cloudy, but if we could see a little further on the valley, we would see the saddle that we will cross to the other side on day three to get to the ice field. On day one, we have a lot of fun wading rivers and many, many streams that come down from the mountain on this icy water that is very cold, and it's milky because of all the debris coming out from the glaciers with the water. So it is a very interesting thing to do, wading these rivers. And in the end of the day, we get to a camp, to this campsite that is the Toro campsite. This is typical campsite, Lenga forest in the Andean forest. On day two, we hike. We start very early with a wade, either a wade or a Tyrolean traverse. It depends on how much water is coming down. The river is too big, then we cross with a Tyrolean traverse. If the river is not too big, like you can see there, then we cross a wade. And what we do on this day, we hike a little bit and we get to the glacier to do an ice trek with crampons. It's an easy ice trek, but it is very beautiful because we get to walk on this place. This is Tunnel Glacier, and we get to walk north over this glacier to see the features that are there, that are very beautiful glaciers with a lot of caves and crevasses, something sort. So this is something that we think is really worth to do. This is not typical. Other agencies offer this tour in 4 days without this ice trek. But we think that visiting Los Glaciares National Park, the Glaciers National Park, and doing a trek like this, having the glacier so close, is a reason enough to try to hike a little bit in the glacier and visit a little bit more. So we offer this day because we think it's really worth it, and we enjoy doing it. So on day three, we hike from camp two to Del Viento Saddle, means the windy. And here in this place, we have seen rocks flying with the wind. We've seen people flying with the wind. In El Chaltén, it is not strange to see house roofs flying with the wind. You know, winds can be very, very, very strong in this part of the world. So imagine having those winds around why this saddle is called the windy saddle. It is perhaps the worst place to be around if it's windy. So it is a nice experience to cross this saddle with wind. And sometimes we can't, you know, if the wind is too strong, sometimes we just can't walk and we have to make a biplan. But sometimes we actually cross it with hard winds and we manage to do it. So we hike up to this saddle next to these two glaciers. The glacier on the right side is the one where we do the ice trek on day two. This is a saddle with a small lake there, and we are almost seeing, having a view to the west side. And once we have an open view to the west side, we see a landscape like this. This is Vietma Glacier and the ice field with Nunatak Vietma on the back and the Mariano Moreno Mountain. That is a huge mountain in the middle of the ice field on the back in the clouds. Here we have another picture, people coming down. Here we still hike like for two more hours until we get to our camp. On the next day, we wake up very early in the morning and we walk from this camp 3 to Tepanos Bay. We hike the west side of the mountains. The hike comes all over this side of the mountains and then comes up to another saddle that we call it Huemul. Once we get this other saddle, we get a very close view of this beautiful glacier. This is the Vietma Glacier that comes down to Lake Vietma and gives us this amazing landscape to see from the top of this saddle. And once we cross the saddle to the other side, we have a first glimpse to what will be our camp 4. Camp 4 is down here. Our icebergs that actually come from the glacier that we've seen in the previous picture. All these icebergs move in the lake until they get stuck here near the campsite. Here we have a technical step on the way down to Tempanos Bay. We should use rope, let's say 5 or 6 meters down climb. Very easy terrain, but it is worth using a rope. It is usually wet and it's usually muddy, so we prefer to delay it just in case. So once we get down this step, we get this place that is our camp 4. Here it is camp 4, very close to the iceberg bay. Well, camp 4 is in this iceberg bay. This is sunrise of day 5. It is something that if you are there and you leave it, you can't believe it. It's amazing, an amazing view of the sun coming out in the east, and all the lake and the icebergs are lit by the light of the sun. So this is the morning. Here we have some people preparing breakfast. Our campground is here on the right side. Here you can see the saddle we cross on day 4. We come down to Tempanos Bay and then we hike out. On this day, we have to cross this river. We will not be able to wade this river. It is a deep river. It's an interesting river. The gear we bring, Tyrolean Traverse is fixed there. It is a fixed line. And we cross it one by one. This is a nice adventure and it's a nice experience. Always when I'm hiking, I'm crossing my fingers for the Tyrolean Traverse to be intact, you know? Imagine arriving there and it being cut, no? But no, it never happens. To change a little bit of subject, we'll talk a little bit about the gear we need to do hikes here. We definitely need a big backpack because we are offering things that involve camping. So we need to be able to bring our own sleeping bag, our own mattress, our own tent, and then all the gear you need to hike. About clothing, it is absolutely necessary to bring waterproof clothes to South Patagonia. You need to bring the best waterproof gear you can. And I'm talking about probably Gore-Tex technology, you know, Gore-Tex rain jacket and Gore-Tex pants, because that can make the difference between enjoying or not enjoying an adventure, but it can also make a huge difference between an adventure being something that we can actually do or the need to come back to El Chalten because it is raining. So that is something that can't lack. Then you need warm layers because even though it is summer here, South Patagonia can be very cold during the nights, or if it is windy, it can be very cold. And also it is not strange to have snowstorms during summer. So we have to have the best gear possible. Of course, it can be warm too. In warm days, we have people swimming near the icebergs, but those days are not like the regular thing we have in summer. So we need warm layers. It is advisable to bring a down feather jacket or a synthetic jacket. Probably if it is packable, it is better to have synthetic technology because that would work even though it is wet. So as it is too rainy, perhaps having synthetic technology would be advisable. Everything else you see there, hiking poles, sunglasses, headlamp, camera, perhaps a first aid kit, a water bottle. You know, we don't need to make water drinkable here. Water is drinkable. Well, that is something that I really love about this place. There is so little people going around that the streams are pure and you can drink water. So there are some questions that people usually ask me about coming to this place. Do I need to be an extreme hiker for coming to one of these trips? No, you don't need to be an extreme hiker. You know, sometimes Patagonia looks like something very wild and something very far and difficult. And well, that is not true at all. If you come to the first hike that we mentioned, the Cerro Torre and Fitzroy Base Camps hike, it is an easy to medium level hike and almost anyone can do it. If you don't feel like packing all the stuff you need for camping, you can always hire a porter or you can ask us to change a little bit the itinerary so that we can do it without so much weight. And then we can customize the product for you, for your level and for your needs. But you don't need to be an extreme hiker. And if you want to do the Huemul loop, then you need a little bit more of experience or fitness. You can also hire porters, but you will be carrying weight because it is a five-day hike. And also you have to be willing to hike long distances, do long climbs during the day. And when I mean long distances, I mean days of 10 to 18 kilometers and hiking. Some days you have to hike up 1,000 meters of elevation and do some technical passages that you need to do. But it is not extreme at all. We are talking about hikes that are not extreme. They are easy. If you need any technical mountain gear, we try to include every technical mountain gear that is needed from the products we offer. So if you need something and it is not included and you need it, you can actually rent it in El Chaltén. There are many places to rent gear. You can rent sleeping bags, you can rent mattresses, tents, crampons, helmets, harnesses, and everything you need. So if you don't want to bring it or you don't have it, you don't need to worry about that. There is always a plan B. A B plan if the weather is not good for hiking. We are determined to push through weather and try to do the best experience possible with the weather we have. But sometimes, just in terms of safety, it is not safe to hike with some weathers, and we decide to make B plans. And there are B plans because the east part of the national park is very dry, as I told you before. And usually when the west part of the national park is rainy or snowy, we can move to the east part. There are a lot more options for hiking and mountaineering. We are glad to answer any question you have. We can plan rock climbing, as ice climbing, skiing in winter, or other hikes that you think that you would prefer. And we can also do something very interesting with these two different hikes, that is linking them. You can start first hike with that is 3 days. You can do the first 2 days and then go from day two, already ready to do day two of the second hike. I love long traverses, and with a tour like that, you get the full experience of South Patagonia. So this is what we offer for this year. We are a certified guide with a lot of experience in the area, hikes between 3 and 5 days, the food during the duration of the tours, for the Huemul loop, the shuttle back to El Chaltén, a lot of, all the technical gear needed and the insurance for every client. What is not included is the personal gear, the camping gear, and the transportation and the travel insurance. If you want to join us, these are the prices for these products: Fitzroy and Cerro Torre, the optional day, and the Huemul loop and the ice trek. And these are the dates that we are offering this summer. We are hiking Fitzroy and Cerro Torre base camp between the 1st and 3rd of February. Then we have February the 4th, we have an extra day for this optional hike. And then on the 6th, between the 6th and the 10th, we will be hiking the Huemul loop and the ice trek. I would love to see you all people here in El Chaltén. Don't hesitate of contacting me for any information you need. Goodbye.